three-dimensional transformation. In that, in three-dimensional transformation, we can rotate, translate, reflect any object. We can move up and down, back and forth, etc. in order to obtain an understanding of its shape. What is it means? That is, in three-dimensional transformation, if you take any object, we can rotate that object in 3D space. Also, we can translate, that is, we can change its position, or we can reflect that object in 3D space. For what purpose? In order to obtain an understanding of its shape. So, therefore, to study 3D transformation, we introduce homogeneous coordinate so that we can translate or shift the origin from its original position to another position. If we have to study three-dimensional transformation, we have to must introduce the homogeneous coordinates, so that we can study the object in 3D space. We can translate or shift the origin from its original position to another position by using three-dimensional transformation. Hence, a point in 3D space, that point is x, y, z, is presented by a 4D position vector, that is x, y, z, h. Actually, our point is x, y, z in 3D space. But it is represented by 4D position vector x, y, z, h, where h is the homogeneous coordinate. Okay. If we take any object or take some point, say x, y, z, we can represent it in a 4D position vector. For what purpose? To study the any object or any point in 3D space. So we introduce the homogeneous coordinate. Now we study the three-dimensional scaling. That is, first, scaling in x coordinate by a unit, the transformation matrix T, which is equal to the first row having entries a 0 0 0, second row 0 1 0 0, third row 0 0 1 0, and the last is 0 0 0 1, which represents scaling in x coordinate by a unit. Now the second scaling is scaling in y coordinate by e unit. The transformation matrix T represents scaling in y coordinate, that is the matrix having entries, and that matrix is 4 by 4 transformation matrix. 1 e 1 0 0 0 0 e 0 0 0 0 1 0, and the last row is 0 0 0 1. If we transform or take the transformation scaling, if we have to scale any object in any direction, say scaling in x coordinate, second one is scaling in y coordinate. If we have to scale any object or a point in x coordinate by a unit, then we use this transformation matrix. And if we have to scale any object in y direction or in y coordinate by e unit, then we use this transformation matrix. The next effect is scaling in z coordinate by j unit. The given matrix, that is transformation matrix T, is equal to 1 0 0 0 0 1 0 0, and 0 0 j 1, and last one is 0 0 j 0 1, where j is the scaling, produces scaling effect in z coordinate by j units. remember this transformation matrix. The next is uniform scaling by factor A. Uniform scaling means uniformly scale in the direction x direction, y direction, z direction, and if you take h is the homogeneous coordinate, then put this is the uniform scaling by factor A. So here we put homogeneous coordinate, that is value of h is also equal to A, and we get the diagonal matrix having diagonal entries A, and this transformation matrix represents uniform scaling by factor A. Okay, the next point is three-dimensional shearing. For that purpose, consider the point P of xyz, that is we take the point in 3D space, having position vector x, y, z in terms of homogeneous coordinate. We all know that any point can be represented in homogeneous coordinate system, that is by taking h in 4D position vector, we can convert any 3D space point to 4-dimensional space point. So in terms of homogeneous coordinate, P is equal to xyz1. We can write that point in homogeneous coordinate in this way. The off-diagonal terms in the upper left of the 3x3 submatrix of the generalized 4x4 matrix produces shear in 3D. What it means? That is the, if you take this is the 4x4 transformation matrix, and this is the, this matrix is the submatrix of order 3x3. Okay, and it produces shear effect in 3D, because if you take any 3D space point in the 4D position vector, that is xyz1, so we have to must use the transformation matrix of order 4x4, and the submatrix 3x3 produces shear effect. Okay, the next that is the point P star means transform point by using the given point P and the transformation matrix T, that is P star is equal to P into T, which is equal to, we have point P is here xyz1, we write here, and the transformation matrix T is, which is 1 b c 0, d 1 f 0, g i 1 0, 0 0 0 1, which produces the shear effect in the point or in the object. Here we are given that the meaning of that transformation matrix, this effect is shearing in x coordinate proportional to y and z axis by a factor d and g unit respectively. Here you can see that shear in x coordinate, let us see the first column, that is 1 d g 0. If you put at x is equal to 1 and the in y direction and in z direction having unit d and g unit respectively, that produces shearing in x coordinate by a factor d and g unit respectively. In same manner, the second point is given that shearing in y coordinate proportional to x and z axis by factors h and I units respectively. Here you see that shear in y coordinate, say second column in x direction by b unit and in z direction by I unit, it produces a shear effect in y coordinate, and shearing z coordinate proportional to x and y axis by factor c and f unit respectively. Okay, this transformation matrix has meaning this, that is, as we see, sharing in x coordinate proportional to y and z axis by factor d and g unit respectively. Second one is sharing in y coordinate proportional to x and z axis by factor h and I unit respectively. Third one is shearing in z coordinate proportional to x and y axis by factor c and f unit respectively. Next point is three dimensional rotation. First is rotation about x axis, and this transformation matrix represent transformation or rotation of an object about x axis. So for that purpose we take first row and first column as it is, and the cos theta sine, we know into 2 by 2 or in a 2D transformation we take the rotation matrix, that is cos theta sine theta minus sine theta cos theta. Okay, this is the 2 by 2 rotation matrix about x axis. So we take that matrix as a sub matrix of 4 by 4 matrix, and we have the rotation about x axis in 3 dimensional. Okay, remember that transformation matrix. In same manner we can obtain the transformation matrix, that is which represents rotation about y axis, that is t is equal to, this is the matrix, we take this column and this row as it is, as in the identity transformation matrix, and put the put cos theta minus sin theta cos theta here, and we know that as in we take the any point in four dimensional position vector, so the fourth row and fourth column becomes as it is, as in the identity transformation matrix. So we have the transformation matrix which represents rotation about y axis. This is the t is equal to cos theta 0 minus sin theta 0 0 1 0 0 sin theta 0 cos theta 0 0 0 0 1. Next is rotation about z axis. The transformation matrix t represents rotation about z axis. So here third row and third column as it is, and we put the rotation matrix about z axis as we use in the 2D transformation. Put it here, cos theta sin theta minus sin theta cos theta, we get the rotation about z axis. Okay, remember that rotation matrix. Our next point is projection. Let us see the definition of projection. Projection means to transformation of n plus 1 dimensional space to n dimensional space. It means projection is the transformation from higher dimension to the lower dimension by 1. If you take an object in 3D space, and if we have the image in 2D, then it means that transformation is called as a projection. Okay, got it? What is mean by projection? Projection means to transformation of n plus 1 dimensional space to n dimensional space. That is, we transform any object in higher dimension to its lower dimensional space, then that image or that object which is transformed is said to be projected object. Next definition is projector. The rays which create projection of an object are called projectors. What it says? The rays which create projection. Projection is a transformation effect which is produced by a projector, and that rays are called projector. Okay. The next point is types of projection. First is a parallel projection. It has three subtypes: orthographic projection, oblique projection, and axonometric projection depends on the rays are parallel to the plane or perpendicular to the plane. Next one is perspective projection. Perspective projection also has three subtypes, that is single projection, two projection or three projection, or it is also called as single point perspective projection, 2 point perspective projection, and last one is 3 point perspective projection. Here we see the short summary, that is projection and its subtypes of projection. This is a tree diagram for the point projection. Here we see projection has two types, parallel and perspective projection. Parallel projection means projectors are parallel in direction to the plane, that is parallel projection. In short, we write here parallel projectors. Perspective projection means converging projectors, that is the rays which creates projection are called projector. If these rays are converging, then that effect produced by that projector are called perspective projection. Next is parallel projection also has subtypes, that is orthographic projection and oblique projection. Orthographic projection means projectors perpendicular to the view plane. Projectors are the rays which creates or which develop a projection of an object from higher dimension to the lower dimension. So if projectors are perpendicular to the view plane, then it is said to be a orthographic projection. Orthographic projection has also two types, that is multi-view and axonometric. Okay, the orthographic projection view plane parallel to the principal plane. There are two planes actually. If we take the projection effect, then we have two planes, that is view plane and principal plane. If view plane is parallel to the principal plane, then it is called as multi-view orthographic projection. And if view plane is not parallel to the principal plane, then that type of projection, that type of orthographic projection is said to be an axonometric projection. Axonometric projection also has three subtypes, that is isometric, diametric and trimetric. Okay, this is the all types of parallel projection. First, orthographic oblique. Orthographic has two subtypes, multi-view, axonometric. Axonometric also have three subtypes, isometric, diametric and trimetric. Now, the next point of parallel projection or next point of parallel projection is oblique projection. If projectors not perpendicular to view plane, then that type of parallel projection is called oblique. Oblique projection has two types, cavalier and cabinet projection. We see that projection in the next point. Now, if projectors are converging, then it is called as perspective. Perspective projection also has three subtypes, that is 1 point, 2 point and 3 point, or we called it as single point, 2 point or 3 point. One principal vanishing point. If we have vanishing point is one, then it is called as 1 point perspective projection. If two principal vanishing point occurred in the projection, then it is called as perspective, 2 point perspective projection. And if the three principal vanishing points are occurred in the projection, then it is called as 3 point perspective projection. Okay, the next point is vanishing point. Vanishing point is these points are formed by intersection of lines parallel to one of the three principal axes. Intersection of lines parallel to one of the three principal axes. We have three principal axes, that is x axis, y axis and last one is z axis. Intersection of lines parallel to one of the three principal axes. It is called as a vanishing point. The number of principal vanishing points is determined by number of principal axes intersected by the view plane. Okay, the number of principal vanishing point, how it is calculated? It is calculated by the number of principal axes intersected by the view plane. Thank you.